All right, just to be clear, I'm doing this because I lost a bet, and I'm sorry you have to see this or hear it. You and me come from different worlds. You like to laugh at me when I look at other girls. Sometimes you're crazy, and you wonder why. I'm such a baby, cause the dolphins make me cry. Well, there's nothing I can do. I only wanna be with you. Hey there, guys, and welcome to Mailbag, the show here on Collider Video, where all we do is take your mailbag questions. And right now, you and me are going to make an agreement that what we just saw never happened. My name is John Campy, and I'm so glad you're joining me today. As I said before, we're going to take all the questions that you guys have sent in, at least as many as we can. We're going to get through just as many as we can. We're taking them from our email address, which, by the way, if you want a topic or a question to get on Movie Talk Monday through Friday during our mailbag segments, or you want to see them maybe pop up on Mailbag here on the weekends, email us anytime at collidervideo@gmail.com. I also pull some questions from my Twitter, from my Facebook. Wherever you guys can send me questions, I'll probably try to pull some questions from there as well. And with all that out of the way, let's get into it. And the first question today comes to us from Lincoln Olerking, who writes, do you think that rebooting The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings as a TV series, call me crazy, but I actually think it would be cool to see it like that. You get like four seasons out of all six movies. Thanks for answering my question. Well, Lincoln, look, I'm all for the idea of taking, personally, some properties and whatever. And I think some properties would be better suited for a longer form television series versus like a motion picture and stuff like that. Lord of the Rings, though, I'm not sure Lord of the Rings works, though, to be honest with you. Because, no, I don't think you can get, like, a season out of each book. Because if you look at the Lord of the Rings trilogy as a whole, even the ridiculous, like, 3.5 hours, you're talking about 11 episodes? So maybe you get one season of television out of the entire Lord of the Rings franchise. Unless, of course, you really want to stretch things out and draw things out. But I think you're just going to annoy a lot of people if you stretch it out and draw it out like that. Or you're going to have to start adding a lot of content that isn't in the books, and that might end up irritating some people as well. But the other thing is, because we've already had those Lord of the Rings films, and you know everybody out there right now, we're all accustomed to Lord of the Rings being of a certain production value, you can't do what they did. What Peter Jackson did with the movies, I don't think you can do on television. And I think it'll come across as a cheap Lord of the Rings. I mean, like, they do a magnificent job on Game of Thrones, but Game of Thrones, very, very, very rarely will you see big monster set pieces. Usually it's three or four people alone in the woods or alone in a castle. And it's great. I mean, Game of Thrones is fantastic. It's unbelievable. And it's meant to be shown like that. And I just don't know that you can do the same thing with Lord of the Rings. Again, I'm not saying it's impossible. It's certainly possible. I just think that because the movie versions are so recent and everybody has seen the movie versions, I think if you did a television series, they would be compared to the theatrical series, and that's not going to be a good comparison. I don't think that'll match up well. But that's certainly not to say they couldn't do it maybe in 10 years, 15 years, somewhere down the line. And you just have to do a lot of adaptation with it to get it to stretch out long enough to do everything that I think that they would want to do with it. So anyway, that's just my thoughts on it. Thanks a lot for your question. The next question comes from Al, who writes, I was watching the trailer for Amy Schumer's new movie, Snatched, and I couldn't help but notice the overwhelmingly negative comments and the thumbs down. My question is, if this film bombs, what does that mean for Amy's career? And wasn't she just offered $10 million for her next film? Will that be affected? Thanks, and bring on the filthy. Well, thanks a lot for the question, Al. Yeah, the new trailer for Amy Schumer, I think it's Goldie Hawn, who's in it, who plays her mom in it, this new movie, Snatch. The trailer came out last week. And look, I'm a big fan of Trainwreck. Trainwreck was one of those really pleasant surprise comedies for me last year. I enjoyed it a great deal. I thought it was very funny, and I thought Amy was terrific in it. I really do. I enjoyed it very much. Matter of fact, on a $35 million budget, Trainwreck made $145 million. I mean, that's a win in anybody's books, all right? On a $35 million budget. But, yeah, man, that Snatched trailer is awful. It's awful. Now, that's not... Remember, how many times have we seen awful trailers to movies that ended up being really good? Or vice versa, we've seen magnificent trailers to movies that end up really being really bad. I mean, yes, for the most part, bad trailers are bad movies and good trailers are good movies. But we all know there are lots of exceptions. And maybe this is one of those exceptions. But if we're just talking about the trailer itself, yeah, that trailer is bad. So what does it do, Al is asking, to Amy's career if this movie bombs? Honestly, I don't think it does much. Because at that point, she's 1-1. I think because she has so much goodwill right now, because her TV series is very popular, because of the hit that Trainwreck was, I think she could survive and weather one big bomb. And if Snatched is that big bomb, and remember, that's a massive assumption because who knows, the movie could be great. But if it's a bomb, I honestly don't think it would hurt her momentum too much. Now, she does Snatch, and that ends up being a bomb, and then she puts out another comedy, and that ends up being a bomb. Well, then maybe you start getting worried. But at this point, she's riding on so much momentum coming off Trainwreck that I think she could survive it. But again, we've only seen one trailer. Let's wait to see another trailer and whatever, and then let's wait to see the movie. But yeah, this trailer did look pretty damn awful. No doubt. Thanks a lot for the question, Al. All right, next question. Patrick Harden writes, I've been catching up on a lot of movies lately, and one of those was John Carter, which I'd read the source material a year or so back, but never saw the movie. How did that movie bomb at the box office? It was decent little adventure flick. Thanks a lot, Patrick. Yeah, actually, you know what? You'll hear John Schnepp and I talk about John Carter a lot, because I don't think that John Carter was just a decent little adventure flick. I actually thought John Carter was incredibly imaginative, great sci-fi. I thought it was really a good, true, old-fashioned styled sci-fi adventure. I loved John Carter. I didn't just like it a lot. I loved John Carter. I thought that movie was incredibly fun. Very well made. Andrew Stanton directed it, and I thought he did a terrific job with it, but the movie bombed. And, you know, guys like John Schnepp and I, he and I both agree that we think Disney just really botched the marketing on that. And I understand, how do you market a film like John Carter? John Carter is it's a tricky film to market. But first of all, it was a terrible title, John Carter. The original title was John Carter of Mars. But, you know, some brainiac somewhere thought, oh, there was a movie about Mars not, you know, a while ago, and it didn't do well. So movies with the title Mars in it won't do well. And they took it out and you left it John Carter. That could be a movie about your accountant. Not the cool Ben Affleck style accountant either. Just your regular boring accountant. I mean, what did that communicate? What did John Carter communicate? And then the trailers and the poster. Remember the poster? It's John Carter in some arena with like some blind giant ape creature. And it's like that. It's confusing. The title didn't communicate anything about it. The trailers didn't do the movie any favors. So I'll be honest with you. When I went to go see the movie, I was expecting a bad film because of all that stuff. And I think a lot of the movie-going audience were expecting a bad film too. And that's why not a lot of people went to go see it, because it was that bad. But yeah, like, believe me, John Carter is one of those films. Whenever we talk about good movies that got sabotaged by terrible marketing campaigns, John Carter is always going to be in that conversation to me, because it was a movie that I thought deserved much better. It was a movie that executed itself really well and was actually pretty damn entertaining, but they just didn't end up delivering on it. And it just goes to show that you need to have a good marketing campaign to go along with your movies, because look, right or wrong, the audience listens to trailers. The audience primarily bases their decision. Yeah, they listen to critics, and yes, they listen to word of mouth from their friends. But primarily, most people base their decision on whether or not they're going to go see a movie on a trailer. And you botch those trailers, man, you're already starting, you know, in a big hole. You're already starting in a big deficit, and you got to fight your way out. All right, thanks a lot for the question. The next question comes from Justin Tretiav. Tretiav? Anyway, Justin, sorry, I butcher names. Everybody knows this. And he writes, "Hey, John, been watching since the AMC days. Thank you very much. I noticed that recently you've gone back to the old AMC style of doing mailbag. I'm just curious, is this going to continue going on? It is my favorite way of doing them, but does this signal a shift in the strategy for mailbag?" All right. Thanks a lot for the question. Yeah, a bunch of people noticed. You might have recognized that a few weeks ago, when I was in Canada during the Christmas break, obviously Collider was shut down, and I knew a lot of people still wanted mailbag. So I decided to do mailbag from Canada. When I came back, and by the way, a lot of people don't realize this, this style of mailbag, this is the way mailbag always was. This is the way mailbag got started, this way it was created. Mailbag was originally created to be different from all the other shows that we did. Because, you know, all the other shows we do are panel discussions. It's a table with four people or three people, what have you, and going back and forth. And that's the way most of our shows are. Anyway, way back in the day, we created Mailbag for a couple reasons. One, we wanted something that was different from Movie Talk. And number two, we wanted something to have programming on the weekends because a lot of our viewers were asking for more content on the weekends. And so that's what we did. Now, eventually, I started getting really busy and I started to bring in help on Mailbag. So then Mailbag for a while was me and Ashley Mova. And Ashley Mova did a great job on that show. So Ashley Mova would ask the questions, I would answer them, and then she would ask follow-up questions of her own. And it was a really nice thing. I loved my partnership with Ashley on those. We had a lot of fun on that. But then what started happening was I started getting busier and busier and busier. And I started looking for other people around here to do mailbag. And I won't name names, but what the problem with that was, because we had this philosophy of making it different from Movie Talk, we wanted it to be more personal, more one-on-one, all that kind of stuff. But the problem was that nobody on our staff felt comfortable doing a single person show. Not a lot of people here felt comfortable that they could carry a one-person show, and that they could, you got to be a special kind of stupid to be able to sit in front of a webcam and just talk for an hour without anybody else to talk through. I just happen to be that special kind of stupid. And there wasn't really anybody else on the crew or on the staff that felt comfortable doing that. They didn't feel that they could do it. I felt a couple of them could do it, but they didn't. So whatever. So when I needed to start pulling back and pull myself off of mailbag, we started doing it with panels, and it became like Movie Talk, except just the ending part of Movie Talk and all that kind of stuff. But anyway, fast forward now, and I did that while I was away on Christmas vacation. And then what happened was, as you know, we just launched a brand new show called Awesometacular. It's on the Verizon Go 90 network. You can also watch the shows 1 week late on the Go 90 YouTube channel. So you can go check those out there. I'm going to put links to the Awesometacular stuff, both on the Go 90, where you can get the newest episodes, and the YouTube channel, where you can follow them 1 week late with Jeremy Johns. It's the best show we've ever produced. It's amazing. It's certainly the best show I've ever been a producer of. And I love working with Jeremy Johns on it. We have a great team of people around here with writers, and Ken Knapsack and Mark Riley and Josh McCuga doing a lot of the writing on it. And just, it's just been a terrific collaboration with everybody around here, and Jeremy Johnson working with Verizon Go 90 for doing that show. And doing that show pays a lot of the bills around here, which is also great. But so coming back from the Christmas holidays, we had a meeting and we were like, you know, we've been shooting mailbags, little secret, we've been shooting mailbags on Fridays, but Fridays are getting incredibly busy. Studio time is getting really, really tight, and we don't have time to do things. That and a lot of our crew's schedule were getting really tight. Our production people and behind the scenes people and all that stuff was getting really, really tight. And so we sat down, leadership and I sat down, we're like, what can we do to alleviate, to take some of the pressure off people and take some of the pressure off the studio and free up more of the studio time to make way not only for Awesometacular, but a bunch of other new shows we're developing. Just going to let you in on that right now. And we thought, you know what, let's go back. And the leadership, we all sat down, we decided, let's go back to the original style of mailbag, of doing it one person, more intimate, one-on-one with the audience. Obviously, we don't need the studio to do it. I'm able to produce it and shoot it and edit it all by myself instead of a crew of four or five other people. And we thought, let's do that. And then something funny happened. The last 2 weeks, and this is the interesting thing, the last 2 weeks prior to this weekend, the last 2 weeks have been the biggest numbers mailbag has had all year. And I don't just mean all of 2017, but I mean, it's been the biggest numbers the mailbag has had all year. Both weekends, the mailbags combined crossed 100,000 views, and that's the first time that's happened in ages. I think it's the first time it's happened since back in the day when I used to do it. And so obviously, I mean, and so obviously people were still watching. The trick is, though, whenever you change formats, it's, and you make something different, it's jarring for the audience. It absolutely is. And so, you know, there are a number of people who were uncomfortable with the new way of doing mailbag and all that kind of stuff. See, this is the type of stuff I love doing mailbag for, is to share the actual behind the scenes stuff of what goes on here at Collider during the week. But you know, one of the things was, and I knew this would happen, and I was totally prepared for it, because whenever you change things on people, it's jarring and it causes some discomfort. Totally understandable. I get it. And so, you know, a bunch of people saying, oh good, it's the old way of movie talk, but, or old way of doing mailbag. But some people were uncomfortable with it, saying, ah, this is different. I've been tuning into mailbag for like 8 months. And mailbag was this. So like a lot of viewers who had only been around for about 8 months, mailbag was one thing, and now it's something different and it's uncomfortable. And so, yeah, this is the way we're doing mailbag now. And, you know, the views have been great. I've been getting lots of great comments, a lot of critical comments too, and that's fine. But we are just feeling right now that when it comes to panel discussion shows, we have a lot of those. When it comes to just more intimate, personal, one-on-one type of shows, we don't have any. And so we thought we would do it this way. Now, what I am trying to do, just so you know, is I am trying to make it, because, you know, I need to be careful of my schedule too. I am trying to get it so I can get one or two other people as well to come in and do them some weekends. So it's not every single mailbag show is just me, but I can get somebody else to come in and do it. I'm still running into that problem where I'm having a hard time getting anybody around here to feel comfortable enough to sit in front of a camera and just talk for an hour. But I'm pretty sure I got a couple of people on my list that I'm pretty sure I can get into it, and I'm pretty sure I can talk into doing it. So yeah, this is the new way of us doing mailbag. It's been great because it does get us back to our roots of how we used to do it, but also it frees up our studio time. It puts much less pressure on a lot of our production people who were getting overworked and overwhelmed. And at that point, even though I'm really busy, you know, I got to step up and do what I can do to alleviate that pressure, to free up the time for the studio, to free up the creative people to work on the other things they have working on, to make sure they don't get overburdened with effort, get other people trained up to do this as well, and make the change. And I think it's going to be great. So I'm excited about it. I know it's not for everybody. Just like when I switched mailbag from a one-person thing to a panel thing, it wasn't for everybody. A lot of people complained when I did that the first time. When I switched mailbag from a one-person thing to a multiple people thing, a lot of people complained. It was that jarring effect again. It was uncomfortable. And, you know, it's totally understandable. It's totally understandable. And I don't fault anybody who's been an audience member of mailbag for, say, just 6 months. And for this to be something different, it's an adjustment period. I get it. I totally get it. I understand it. It's totally natural. But this is the way we're going to be doing mailbag from now on. Won't always be me, but this is the way we're going to do mailbag right on for now, because it gets back to the original vision. It frees up studio time and it makes mailbag different than all of our other shows. So that's what we're doing. And I know that won't be for everybody, but no show we have on Collider Video is for everybody. So thank you so much, guys, for hanging in there with us and going through the change with us. I really appreciate it. Keep your eyes open for all the really cool things we got coming in the future. All right. Thanks a lot for the question. Now we move on to Gabriel Amaya, who writes, what is the worst movie you've ever seen? You know, it's funny because a question like that came up on Twitter during movie talk, I think it was last week, about worst movies we've ever seen. I have an unholy trinity of three movies that to me are the worst movies. Worst big budget, wide release Hollywood movies. Obviously, there's a lot of trash, little independent stuff, sure. But I'm talking about big budget, wide release Hollywood releases. There are three that are the unholy trinity of, in my opinion, the worst motion pictures ever made. number, in no particular order, okay? Number one, Catwoman with Halle Berry. That movie, that movie is so disappointing because Halle Berry rocks. Halle Berry is so great, and Catwoman could be such an awesome character, and they just butchered it. She's got the powers of the ancient Egyptian goddess? What? Anyway, clearly knew nothing about Catwoman. That aside. So Catwoman is one of them. The next one is Highlander 2, The Quickening, which is really weird because the first Highlander is still, for you, some of you have heard me talk about the Highlander before, is in my all-time top 10 favorite movies list. That's the one movie on my top 10 list that everybody goes, what? And scratches their head. But I'm sure a lot of us have like one movie on our top 10 list that make other people scratch their heads. And that's mine. I just adore the original Highlander. But the second Highlander was such a steaming pile of shit. It was so bad. It not only was it bad in its own right, but it took everything we knew about the first one and crapped all over. It's like, wait a minute. The immortals are criminal convicts from another world whose punishment is to be put on Earth to live forever. That's their punishment. I mean, it was just terrible. And I was really excited too because Michael Ironside was going to be in and was in Highlander Part 2. And I was so excited for that to show up alongside Christopher Lambert and everything. And Sean Connery came back. And it just went to crap. It was so bad. Anyway, don't get me going on Highlander Part 2 because I could talk all day. And then third in this unholy trinity is Battlefield Earth. My goodness. Now, I know I said that those films were all in no particular order, but if they were in some kind of order, Battlefield Earth would probably top the list as the most outrageously, most awful, terrible film, wide release, big budget Hollywood film ever made. Now, I might have told this story before a couple of years ago, but the first time I saw Battlefield Earth, at the time I was working in a visual effects company. I was a producer and a client services guy at a visual effects company. And the core people in our company happened to know somebody that was involved in the visual effects of Battlefield Earth. And I'm a big sci-fi guy, so we were all excited to go see Battlefield Earth. So I was living in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, Canada at the time, which is not far from the city that Deadpool mentions in Deadpool of Regina, Saskatchewan. It's actually very close. But anyway, so I'm in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, Canada. We go to this movie theater and we watch Battlefield Earth. And I'm telling you, within like the first 5 minutes, I knew I was watching something epically bad, like just epically horrible, right? So we sit down through the and watch the entire movie. And here's the funny part, at least to me it was. You know, when a movie ends and the credits start to roll, you know, the audience starts to hustle and bustle and standing up. It was winter time at the time, stand up, putting on their coats, get ready to go, right? That didn't happen. The credits started to roll and nobody in this packed 500 person auditorium moved a muscle. Everybody was dead still, like deer caught in a headlights. And this lasted for what felt like hours, but it was probably only about 12 to 15 seconds. But I'm telling you, it was so awkward, it felt like it was lasting for hours. So 12 to 15 seconds of this dead silence in the theater with people just sitting in their seats, not moving, dead quiet other than the music of the trailer rolling or of the credits rolling. And all of a sudden you hear this voice yell out from the front of the theater, "What the hell was that?" And the whole audience just erupted in laughter. Anyway, that was my experience with that. So when you ask me what I think is the worst movie ever made, it's The Unholy Trinity. It's Catwoman. It's Highlander Part 2, The Quickening. And probably the granddaddy of them all, you got Battlefield Earth, which is just rubbish. Anyway, next question comes from Andrea Elizabeth Marie, who writes, What is your opinion on TV shows adapted from movies? Lethal Weapon, Minority Report, Taken. This hasn't been a successful trend so far from what I've seen. Yeah, we got a new one coming out. There's a new one for Training Day coming out based on the Denzel Washington, Ethan Hawke movie. So that's coming out here pretty soon and it looks terrible. I'm going to admit something. I haven't watched any of those shows. None. I haven't watched the Lethal Weapon one. I haven't watched the Minority Report one. I have no plans at all to watch the Training Day one. All I can say is that I have, you know, people I know who watch a lot of TV are not really big. Actually, I've heard some people say not bad things about Minority Report. So I take that back. I mean, I haven't talked to anybody who loves the show per se, but I've talked to some people that actually don't mind it. I've talked to a couple people that hated it, but I've heard some not bad things about Minority Report. But as far as the other ones, especially Lethal Weapon, I everybody tells me just avoid it. So anyway, remember though, I haven't seen them. So don't take my word for it. I have not seen them. So I'm not speaking from a position of knowledge on this. I'm just telling you things I've heard. So take that for what it's worth. Thanks a lot for the question, Andrea. The next question comes from Eloy Vasquez, and he writes, any chance for a Guns N' Roses biopic? You know, I'll be honest with you. The idea of biopics on musicians, very few and far between actually interest me. There are a couple, that would and do interest me. And Guns N' Roses is probably one of the ones that would interest me. There's a lot of behind the scenes drama. And some of it's very well known, but it's behind the scenes drama with that band, their meteoric rise to fame. Oh my God, when they came out, that album was like everything and everywhere. I mean, I remember everybody in my school, whether they were rockers or whatever, like the cliques and groups were when I was in high school, everybody loved that album. Everybody talked about the Guns N' Roses album and all the strange things that have happened to them along the way. Do I believe there's a chance? Well, it really depends. What the real chances depend on is, do the principals involved, are they going to give permission for somebody to make a movie based on that and telling, let's face it, some not so flattering stuff? Like a biopic about Guns N' Roses is going to have a lot of unflattering stuff. You know this. And are these guys who are still active, these guys who are still rocking, these guys who still have, who are touring and doing their thing, do they want a movie coming out showing a lot of the bad things? Not just bad things, is I did a lot of drugs and alcohol. No. I mean like bad things. Things that would make you question whether you want to listen to them or not. And like every musician has that in their backgrounds. They all do. But the thing that I would say there would be a lot of interest from studios, I would think, to make a Guns N' Roses biopic. I think there'd be a lot of directors and filmmakers and writers out there who would love to take a crack at doing a Guns N' Roses biopic. Personally, I think the big roadblock is going to be Guns N' Roses themselves. I don't think they would probably be all that keen on that movie getting made, but who knows? You never know. All I can say is that I, for one, would be interested in a Guns N' Roses biopic. All right. Next question comes from Tiffany R. Hoffman, who writes, what is your favorite soundtrack? Ooh, well, look, it's, honestly, it's the Star Wars. And, you know, when I talk about Star Wars, I mean, the whole original trilogy, so much fantastic, memorable music. I mean, the Imperial March is the greatest piece of music ever created by mankind. There's no more other piece of music that gets me more than the Superman theme, more than the indie theme, more than anything else. It's that original, the Imperial March is still the granddaddy of them all. It's still the great one to me. I love it. So mine would probably be all the Star Wars stuff. Thanks a lot for the question, Tiffany. Next question comes from Cameron Resendez, who writes, since Marvel's comic universe was established as being interconnected from the beginning, do you think that helped to give the company an advantage over DC when it came to creating a cinematic universe? No, not really. Because they planned for it to be a cinematic universe. But if you watch the first Iron Man movie, aside from that after credits scene with Nick Fury showing up and going, we got something called the Avengers Initiative, you know, they got everybody excited. Aside from that after credits scene, that Iron Man movie is very much a standalone movie. In every sense of the word, that Iron Man movie is a standalone one-shot movie that had the potential for sequels if they wanted to do sequels. And they put in that little after credit scene to create an expanded universe. The key is they made a great movie that people, the audience loved, the critics loved, and the box office loved. They did that. had Green Lantern with Ryan Reynolds, had Green Lantern been great and had all those three things that that first Iron Man movie had, the audience loved it, the critics loved it, the box office loved it. Had it done all those three things, you bet your ass that would have been the start of the new DC Cinematic Universe. You bet your ass that would have been the start of the new DC Cinematic Universe. You see, the difference between Iron Man and, say, Green Lantern, or the Marvel getting its cinematic universe going, DC trying to get a cinematic universe going, isn't that one was planned as a thing from the beginning where the other wasn't. No, the difference is one was great and one was not. That's the difference. And then even when you move into, obviously, Man of Steel was meant to be the first film of a new shared DC cinematic universe. And I will, to this day, I will fight you to my dying breath. Man of Steel is a fucking masterpiece of a movie. It's a masterpiece. The more I watch it, every time I watch it, I am more and more convinced of how great that movie is. There is depth and subtlety and nuance in it that I think a lot of people just glaze over. That movie is freaking brilliant, all right? I love it. But it doesn't matter the fact that I loved it that much. The reality is it was divisive. Some people liked it, some people didn't. I mean, that's the reality of it. I can stick my head in the sand just because I'm a fan of it and say, no, everything's awesome. No, I mean, a lot of people didn't like it and they had their reasons and that's fine. So that wasn't because it was mixed response. It made a lot of money, but it wasn't a $1 billion film. The critics were kind of split on it 50-50 roughly. And the audience was better than 50-50, but not, you know, you go around talking to average film fans, people don't love Man of Steel the way I love Man of Steel. And so that was another hindrance too. So no, what gave Marvel a foot up wasn't the plan, the initial plan, wasn't, oh, we didn't originally intend the first, no. It all came down to Iron Man was great. Green Lantern was not. And even the follow-up after Green Lantern, once they realized, okay, screw that, let's start again, and they did Man of Steel, it didn't have the reception that they wanted it to have. I mean, they got the reception they wanted from me, but they didn't get the reception from everybody else. And so that is the thing that really gave Marvel the advantage. It was that their first film out of the gate to create this new universe was awesome, while DC's was not. And DC's kind of been fighting uphill ever since. But I honestly believe this, with Ben Affleck being there, should Warner Brothers stay out of his way and let him make the film that he wants to make, I believe DC can really, after these next 2 years, can really emerge as going toe-to-toe with Marvel again. I really believe that. I truly do. And let's just see how that all goes. Thanks a lot for the question, Cameron. Next question comes from Hector Arvizu, who writes, how do you guys set up your movie commentary videos? I love them so much, and you guys look like you're having such a fun time commentating on your favorite movies. I would love to know how you set up those videos so my brother, sister, and I can try to start our own commentary videos. Thanks, and keep doing what you're doing. You guys are the best. Thanks a lot, Hector. Yeah, we love doing our commentary videos. Although we haven't done one for a while. But trust me, actually, just me, Schnepp, Christian and Dennis and Wendy were just sitting out there the other day talking about, when are we going to do another commentary video? What's the next one we should do? Definitely we're going to do Doctor Strange, but that doesn't come out for a little while. We're definitely going to do one for Guardians of the Galaxy when we get closer to Guardians of the Galaxy 2 coming out. So we're definitely doing that. I'm not sure which other ones we're going to do, but we want to get another one done soon. How do we shoot them? They're as simple as can be. Dennis sets up a camera, points it at the four of us, and that's it. It's the simplest thing we do, and we just sit there and talk through a movie. Now, here's the thing about these commentary videos. Some people say, why don't you guys put the movie down in the corner so I can see the movie as you guys are talking about it? Because we don't want to go to jail. That's why we don't put that down there. Imagine that. There's this little thing called copyright law and copyright infringement. But I get it. I mean, because the people do like trailer reactions, they put that little down there. But putting the whole movie on YouTube, that's a great way to get us shut down. So no, we can't do that. What we need to do is we do that. but you have to have the movie yourself too. So we do our commentary of, say, Revenge of the Sith. You have Revenge of the Sith. You put your Revenge of the Sith on your TV or Revenge of the Sith on one monitor, and then you open us up on another monitor, line them up, hit play, and then watch the movie along with us. And really, the way we do commentaries, they're not really commentaries, are there? They're more watch-alongs with us than commentaries, but we have a lot of fun. We're going to have more doing. So to answer your question, Hector, it's the simplest thing in the world. We just put one camera on us, hit record, and that's it. And you can certainly do it too. Just when you do it, make sure the camera can't see your TV because that's putting copyrighted material on YouTube and you can't do that. And don't have the volume turned up too loud on your TV, because the audio track playing on a YouTube thing would also technically be a violation of the terms of use and you'd be violating copyright. You shouldn't do that. So just be careful how you shoot it. But generally speaking, just put one camera on you and away you go. And good luck. Good luck making those. They're a lot of fun to do. All right. The next question comes from a buddy of ours, Kevin Rubio, who writes, John, hypothetical question. Bob Iger, who, by the way, Bob Iger is the head grand chief imperial emperor overlord of all things Disney. Bob Iger calls you and offers you your choice of roles in either Marvel, Star Wars, or Disney franchise films. Which franchise do you go with and what role would you want? Well, Star Wars, obviously. And what role would I want? Obviously not an acting role because I'm not an actor. I suck. I've tried acting when I was in high school. I'm terrible at acting. Just awful. Anyway, I would probably want the role of a producer. I do enjoy producing. I love producing. To get in there and be involved creatively with the wizards who do the Star Wars movies, and to have any kind of a part in a Star Wars movie, for me personally, it would be the Star Wars franchise, and the role I would want is one of a producer. Thanks a lot for the question, Kevin. Next question comes from Sonny Dominguez, who writes, which beloved movie hero do other people love yet you cannot resonate with? For me, I can't stand Ferris Bueller. Hey, fair enough. A lot of people love Ferris Bueller. I love Ferris Bueller. But hey, not everybody is for everybody. The most hated movies in the world have some people who like them. The most beloved movies in the world have some people who dislike them. The world seems to love Ferris Bueller and you don't, and that's perfectly okay. For me, I enjoy the movie. I enjoy the movie. But I admit, I don't get, look, I'm not afraid to say the unpopular thing. I never am. I don't care if somebody likes me for my opinion. I don't care if somebody dislikes me for my opinion. I don't hate them. I don't dislike the movie either. But honestly, I've never gotten the obsession with the dude from The Big Lebowski. I've never gotten the obsession with the dude. He's pretty cute and clever with some of the things he says, but overall, it doesn't resonate with me as much. But you're not going to hear me slamming on the dude because so many people love the dude, probably more people than love Ferris Bueller. But if you're going to ask me, if the question is, which beloved movie character that everybody else loves that doesn't necessarily resonate with me, and we all have those, mine would probably be the dude. Thanks a lot for the question. Danny Kramer writes, what are your thoughts on a James Bond movie directed by Denis Villeneuve? I personally think he would be a great director and bring a really cool story and visual appeal to a property we know and love. Thanks. Good question. Look, I love Denis Villeneuve. I mean, his latest thing, The Arrival, I'm not as huge on The Arrival as everybody else is. But when you look down like the last three films he's done, he's amassing a Christopher Nolan-esque kind of resume at this point. And now with talks, I think it's him that they're talking about doing Dune. And he's going to be great at Dune. Look, I say this all the time. Whenever somebody asks me, John, who would you like to act in this? Or John, who would you like to direct that? My answer is always the same. Any one of 100 great directors, any one of 100 good actors. That's generally my thing. So would I like Denis Villeneuve, who is a great director, to direct a James Bond film? Well, Denis Villeneuve is a great director, so sure. Yeah, absolutely. There are other Drake directors you could list too that I would say, yeah, sure, absolutely, as well. But Denis Villeneuve certainly fits the bill. Thanks a lot for the question. The next question comes from Alan Gonzalez, who writes, do you guys have hobbies besides movies and sports? I can't speak for the other guys. Oh, well, like I know Mark Ellis. I mean, he's huge into sports. You know, Christian is just all about movies and Star Wars. I mean, that's everything to him. Schnepp likes going to a lot of concerts. I know that about Schnepp. He likes to go to a lot of concerts. Wendy plays a lot of video games. Jeremy just does whatever Jeremy does. Jeremy is his own weird kind of creature. Myself, me and Anne, we like playing Magic the Gathering. We like playing role-playing games. We like going to the concerts at the Hollywood Bowl. We got a few hobbies. Oh, and me, one of my big things is, of course, that's not involved with sports, is I'm a big poker guy. I love playing poker. I go play in the World Series every year in Vegas. I'm a big poker guy. That's one of my big hobbies is poker. Thanks a lot for the question. Paul Jones writes, hi, John. Do you think with the nonstop questioning over the Batman movie that this could be Ben's first and last directorial DCEU project? Well, haven't we all been talking about Ben Affleck and his Batman a lot lately? No. Now, look, I know Ben Affleck. I think it's safe to say, even when he was putting out the Best Picture of the Year winner at the Oscars with Argo, and he was getting all of his acclaim as a director for Gone Baby Gone and The Town, I don't think he's ever had as much attention. Even as smart, as media savvy as Ben Affleck is, I don't think he's ever had the type of attention that he's got or scrutiny he's got since taking on the Batman franchise. It's like a college coach coming up to the big leagues and managing the New York Yankees. I mean, it's a totally different beast. And I think what we've seen is that Ben, as an artist, has been trying to put this Live by Night movie together, and nobody's paying attention to it. Because whenever they see Ben, all they want to talk about is Batman. So here's this project that he has, this Live by Night project that he has put blood and sweat and tears and energy and effort and creativity into for years. He's been trying to get this movie made. He makes it. He pours himself into it. He loves it. He's ready to share it with the world. And all anybody wants to talk to him about is Batman. But of course, all they want to talk about is Batman because it's Batman. And like, Ben, I get it. Like, you kind of would love some attention to these other projects. But you had to know that you take on Batman, people are going to want to talk to you about Batman. Why? Because interviewers who come talk to you, that's what their viewers and readers want to know about. The reason these interviewers are asking Ben about Batman all the time is not necessarily because they personally want to know about Batman that much. Probably most of them do, but that's not necessarily the case. The case is probably more like those interviewers know that's what their audience is interested in. Like, if I got an interview with Ben Affleck, and I've interviewed Ben Affleck before, but if I had an interview lined up with Ben Affleck and I had 2 minutes to talk to him, it's probably safe to say, I'm going to lower my chair a bit, it's probably safe to say that at least half of that interview, doesn't matter what I'm there to talk to him about, I'm going to need to ask him about Batman. Why? Because that's what everybody who watches Collider Video really wants to know about. And so Ben just needs to accept that. And you know what? Of course he looks a little irritated about that right now, because now is when Live by Night is coming out. So of course that's it. But you know what? Once Live by Night has come, done its theatrical run, it's done its business, and it's moved on, Ben is going to, I believe, flourish in his role in the DC cinematic universe. I believe he is going to, by the way, please stop trying to correct me when I say DCU instead of the DCEU. DCEU sounds stupid. I don't care if that's what DC calls it. I'm never going to call it that. Just like Lucasfilm can call the Star Wars anthology movies Star Wars stories all they want. I'm never going to call them Star Wars stories. I'm always going to call them anthology. I don't care if that's what they call it or not, because a Star Wars story is a stupid title. So I love them. I love them deeply, but it's a stupid title and I'm going to call it like it is. So I'm always going to say DCU. So don't bother trying to correct me. I know that DC calls it the DCEU, but I'll never call it that because it's a stupid name. Anyway, that's just me. I believe Ben is going to flourish in this role. I think once the Live by Night thing is done, he's going to love that people are looking to him to bring Batman again to the relevance and to the glory that it can be brought to. I think he's going to love the challenge of taking a standalone Batman movie and bring all the great things about his Batman character that we saw in Batman versus Superman. Even most people who hated Batman versus Superman go, yeah, that Batman was actually pretty good. So he's going to take all the good things about that Batman. He's going to take that challenge of bringing those good things into the standalone Batman movie and make it something really special and really awesome. I think he's going to do it, and I think he's going to thrive in it. I really do. So, no, I don't think this will be his last Batman movie. Not at all. All right. Thomas Levesque writes, which comedian would you love to have as a guest on Movie Talk? I'll go with Andrew Dice Clay and Chris D'Elia. I got to admit, I've seen Andrew Dice Clay live. A buddy of mine is a stand-up comedian, and I was at one of his shows, and Andrew Dice Clay just showed up at the comedy club, and they put him on stage. And I'm going to tell you right now, I don't know what you think of Andrew Dice Clay. I know before that night, I didn't think much of Andrew Dice Clay. I thought he was a one-trick pony who just by being really foul-mouthed and swearing a ton made him think he was funny. My mind got changed that night. I saw him live on stage and he tore that room up. He was hilarious. But for me, if I could have one comedian on Movie Talk, not just because I love him as a comedian, but he's in one of my favorite little comedies of all time, which is So I Married an Axe Murderer, the comedian Stephen Wright. If I would give a toe to have Stephen Wright on my show. So that's the comedian I would love to have on Movie Talk. I want to ask you guys, if you could have any comedian out there as a guest on Movie Talk for you guys to watch, which comedian would it be? Let me know in the comment section below. All right, let's get going here. Gustavo Rojas writes, would you guys consider making some sort of vlog, like video blog? Like, for example, how Complex makes the Life at Complex video blogs. Thanks for everything and keep up the amazing work. You know, the funny thing is, Gustav, not too long ago, we actually had a discussion about that. That maybe once a week, we'd have like Perry or somebody else just document like behind the scenes stuff around here. And then every week put up a behind the scenes this week at Collider and just show what's been going on here. We've talked about it and doing stuff like that. And I know I just saw that Life of Complex video blog for the first time like 3 days ago. So it's funny you bring up this question now. I like that. I don't know. Would you guys click on and watch if like every Sunday night we put up a video of like a video blog of Perry kind of video blogging, documenting the behind the scenes stuff at Collider that week? I don't know. Maybe you wouldn't watch it, or maybe you would. Let me know. And that'll help us make some decisions. Thanks a lot for the question. Johan Huth, right? How long did it take for you to upgrade from DVD to Blu-ray? Did it take a lot of convincing, or were you convinced right off the bat? Yeah, this was a big question going around all of movie fandom. When Blu-ray and HD DVD were coming out, when HD was kind of becoming the new standard. And I'm going to admit right up front, I was very late. I was a late adopter. Because, like when I was a kid, I had VHSs. And then the DVD switch came. But the difference between VHS and DVD was amazingly vast. The difference between VHS and DVD, it was night and day difference. A completely different experience watching a VHS and then watching a DVD. So converted all my stuff. I bought all the DVDs. All my VHSs went out. I got all new DVDs, a new TV that could handle, a new DVD player, and all that kind of stuff. Well, it wasn't that long after that that the HD craze hit. And while the reason I was a late adopter to it, and I know a number of my friends were late adopters to it as well, is number one, the price. Because like I think when the first Blu-ray players came out, they were like $1,500 or $2,000, something like that. So it was ridiculous. But besides that, while there was obviously a difference between the quality of a DVD versus the quality of a Blu-ray or HD DVD on an HD TV, the difference wasn't as big as the difference between VHS and DVD. You know, VHS and DVD, you can tell instantaneously if you're watching a VHS or a DVD, they were night and day differences. The quality difference was so vast and so different, it was a different viewing experience. Blu-ray and HD DVD was an improvement. It wasn't, I mean, as far, I still don't think it was a complete different experience. It was an improvement. It was definitely an improvement, but it wasn't that night and day difference enough that it wasn't different enough that made me go, yeah, I'm willing to drop $5,000 to go and get a new TV, a new Blu-ray player, and start replacing all my movies. I mean, it wasn't enough. So I think the Blu-ray stuff was out and available probably for about 3 or 4 years before I finally started to convert. The price point had come way down. They improved their technology a lot. And then it was about 3 or 4 years later that I started to adopt it. But I was certainly not one of the early adopters. I mean, not at all, not even close. Thanks a lot for the question. All right. Next one comes from Alo Barentes, who writes, what Universal Monsters remake are you looking forward to the most? I personally hope they do a Creature from the Black Lagoon. Yeah, that would be cool. For me personally, ever since I saw him pop up in the Mummy trailer, I want to see Russell Crowe's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Now, I know he's going to be in The Mummy, but which one am I looking forward to the most? I want to see that Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde movie. I think that could be really, really cool. All right, just got a few minutes left here, so I'm going to race through as many as I can. Connor Dalton writes, 5 favorite films of all time. Star Wars saga can be counted as one. You know what? I actually don't like addressing those things I don't like making lists, so I'm just going to pass over that one. I will put up on my personal blog sometime my top 10 favorite movies of all time. I've done it before, and I don't think the list has changed in the past 10 years, but I'll double check that and put that up sometime. Cecil Brown writes, if the majority of a movie's profits is made in the cinema, how do movies with a limited release make money? Well, yeah, for a big budget film, like $40 million or more, those movies got to get theatrical releases if they have any hope of getting their money back and ideally making a little bit of profit for the producers. But a lot of these films that go straight to home video, the ones that have limited releases, these are films that don't have $50, $60, $70 million budgets. A lot of these films will have $5 to $25 million budgets. And so how much money they need to make back is a lot more reduced. Plus, a lot of these films that have, $5 to $25 million budgets, they can't afford to put all those films out and do the marketing and the P&A for putting these movies out in wide release. So what they do is they put them out in limited release, get them a little bit of a theatrical run, get some buzz going about them. It also gives more credibility in the eye of consumers. Whether we think this is the way it should be or shouldn't be, that's irrelevant. In the eye of consumers, a movie that has at least been out and had a theatrical run has more legitimacy to them in their eyes. Again, I'm not saying whether that should be the case or shouldn't be the case. I'm simply saying that is the case. So they have these short limited runs, do a little bit of a marketing thing. So when they do their real release on VOD and video on demand and home video and Blu-ray and things like that, they have some public awareness already of their movie. A lot of them are day and date releases as well, which means they come out on, you can stream it on your favorite streaming service as the same day it comes out in limited release in the theater. So those movies have to make a much smaller amount of money to break even and maybe even turn a profit. So they don't need to worry about making a ton of money in their theatrical releases. The standard Hollywood movie does, though they're made for $60+ million. For them to get that kind of money, they need to be in big theatrical wide releases to get the money that they need to turn a profit. Thanks a lot for the question. Okay, I'm going to skip down to the next one. Ross Bristow writes, how does one get DVD screeners? Well, mailbag, I talked about how I had that screener of Moana. One does not go, Ross, you don't go out and get screeners. You have to be pre-selected and invited by the studios to be somebody who receives them. Who do I write to and try to get on a screener list? It's not the way it works. Jonathan Spiroff writes, hey, would you guys be considering adding guest stars from the gaming community on Awesometacular, like Greg Miller from Kinda Funny, or Aaron Hansen from Game Grumps? Yeah, we are definitely, we aren't yet, because we want to get about 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 episodes of Awesome Tacular under our belt, and then we will be going out and bringing in more guests from the gaming world to join Pamela Horton and Jeremy Johns on our gaming segment. But we might also have another show in the works. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. Okay. I'll do two more. I already asked Jonathan Spiranoff. Brenton Oliveres writes, "Hey, John, I've got an industry question. How do smaller production companies produce films? Obviously, big studios have money and investors, but what about little regional production houses? What's their process? Thanks." Smaller houses, again, they make movies with much smaller budgets. So they go out and find investors to invest in their company so they can make their movies for an exchange of the profits of the movie back to their investor. That's an oversimplification, but that's just the general answer I can give right now. Let's see. Adam Chevlieri writes, "Would you like to see a sequel to the movie Fanboys?" Absolutely, I would. I'm a little biased too, because a guy who's a friend of mine, Kyle, he directed the movie. And I think he would make a great one to make another one. Of course, we've had Kyle on Jedi Council before. So yes, I would love to see another version of Fanboys. I think that would be great. All right, guys, listen, that'll do it for me for this installment of Mailbag. This thing's gone on probably a little bit over time. Thanks a lot for joining me. Listen, don't forget, make sure you subscribe to Collider Video. We got movie talk and heroes and Jedi Council and nightmares. And, you know, we've got our crash courses, which a brand new crash course just went up today on everything we know about the Justice League movie right now. It's great. It's hosted by John Schnepp. Make sure you check that out. It's a really good one. One of the best ones we've done so far. And two, make sure, even if you are subscribed to our channel, beside the subscribe button is a little button with a bell on it. This new thing that YouTube has instituted, which is actually kind of dumb, but whatever. Make sure you click that bell, because you won't always be notified of the new episodes that go up on Collider Video. But if you click that bell, that's telling YouTube, make sure you notify me of new videos going up. So do me a favor and just click that bell. You can also follow me on Facebook and on Twitter, simply at John Campia. Make sure you're watching our new show, Awesome Tacular, on Verizon Go 90. And that'll do it for me, guys. Thanks a lot for joining us. My name's John Campia. Until next time, bye-bye.